Are we okay?
Yeah.
It's with really very great pleasure that I introduce tonight's speaker, who I think it's fair to say is one of the most important socialist thinkers today, Leo Panitch. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Canada and the Senior Canada Research Chair in Comparative Political Economy and the Distinguished Research Professor of Political Science at York University in Toronto, as well as the longtime co-editor of the Socialist Register, for which he is currently editing an upcoming edition on the politics of the right.
It's coming.
It's here. Leo Panitch is a major contributor to socialist thought. His numerous scholarly publications include Working Class Politics in Crisis, Essays on Labor and the State, 1986, The End of Parliamentary Socialism, From New Left to New Labor, 2001, Renewing Socialism, Transforming Democracy, Strategy and Imagination, 2001, Together with Sam Gindin, he's written The Making of Global Capitalism, The Political Economy of American Empire, published in 2012. In 2013, the book was awarded the Deutscher Memorial Prize in the UK for the best and most creative work in the Marxist tradition. And in 2014, it won the Rick Davidson Political Economy Studies Book Prize for the best book in political economy by a Canadian. In addition to his prolific scholarship, Professor Panitch also regularly contributes to public discussions about capitalism, labor, and left politics in publications including The Guardian, The Monthly Review, and Jacobin Magazine. For tonight's event, which is co-sponsored by 3CT and the Social Theory Workshop, Professor Panitch will be speaking on the European crisis and the radical left's strategic dilemmas, lessons of the Greek case. Please join me in welcoming Leo Panitch.
Thank you all for coming. Thanks for having me, Moish and Anwen. I was supposed to do this last April. And I'm very glad I didn't, although it would have been nicer to be here in the spring than in the winter. This is almost a year to the day, certainly to the week, since the Syriza government was elected in Greece. So it's a very useful occasion to be talking about this. And what is more, we can see much more clearly now the multiple dimensions that the European crisis is taking at the end of this year. Not only is the crisis of the Eurozone still lingering, but it is overlaid now very obviously by the migration / refugee crisis and the dysfunctionality of the European Union in the face of the Eurozone crisis is now being replicated in the face of the refugee crisis. One also then sees, and much of my last year was actually prepared, not working so much on the left in the crisis as the right in the crisis, as you see, and the current edition of the Register is being passed around. Little did we think when we run on a five-year plan for the Register. It's the last socialist five-year plan probably in the world. Little did we think when we conceived the theme of the 2016 volume that it would be as topical as it is. But you see a very clearly now a political crisis which poses a very fundamental challenge to the globalization of capitalism in Europe, and insofar as it poses it in Europe, it poses it more generally. With the rise of the far right, in Northern Europe in particular, with an explicit project of breaking up the internationalizing project of capital, which, you know, is now some 60 years going. I don't know how far it will go. There aren't national bourgeoisies in Europe of the kind that came, the Ruhr industrialists, etc., that came to Hitler's support. This puts a distinct limit on how far this right can go in breaking up what appeared to be the closest thing to a supranational state that was constructed during the course of the making of a global capitalism. But you see, nevertheless, these dimensions of the crisis. And I don't think that they are quite reducible to the economic one. Certainly, I don't think that the refugee crisis is reducible to the economic one. And the reaction to labor migration, to the migration of people, I think it's wrong to call it labor migration, in Europe, which is, of course, fuel to the fire of the far right. The source of that, I don't think, can be traced directly to the economic crisis. It certainly insofar as it involves people coming across the Mediterranean or around it, that reflects rather the breakup of states in the Middle East that were artificially created during the breakup of the Ottoman Empire at the end of World War I. And I don't think that can be reduced very easily to, you know, reducing it to the economic crisis. The rise of the right is paralleled, although not in the same countries, by a remarkable stirring of the radical left. Syriza most clearly represented that with its electoral breakthrough, first in 2012, then its election. The euphoria which greeted that on the international left was fueled by the success in the referendum called to support the government against the imposition of even more draconian austerity measures, the remarkable success of 61% supporting the government in this, quickly turned to ashes in people's mouths as the government was then forced to back down. And I'll try to deal with why that was so. And a lot of people at that time on the left not only attacked the Syriza government at that moment, this was in July of this year, that's why I'm glad I didn't do this in April. The dilemmas are much clearer now. People immediately attacked the government for capitulation. It became the common term on the left, a term that only entered the leftist lexicon with Chamberlain in 1938. Capitulating to Hitler in Czechoslovakia. But it was a term now applied to the Syriza government. And a lot of people said what the Syriza government was proving was, and was acceding to, was the notion that there is no alternative. And that this would have a very profound deflating effect, a much greater deflating effect on the radical left outside of Greece than the inflating effect of its rise had. That's turned out not to be the case. People thought, with that very summer, you saw for the first time, I think, in half a century, a working class-based party, the British Labour Party, attract to it 400,000 people over the course of a couple of months. Doubling its membership, 97,000 trade union activists joining the party, and then another couple of hundred thousand supporters signing up in order to be able to vote for the most unusual of politicians, the most unconventional of politicians, Jeremy Corbyn, someone I've known since he was, even before he was first elected as an MP in 1983. You also heard that this would have the effect of undermining Podemos in Spain. This hasn't happened. On the contrary, Podemos has made its electoral breakthrough this year, at the end of this year. When Syriza made its electoral breakthrough, it secured 71 seats in 2012 in the Greek legislature. Podemos has just secured 69 in the Spanish. So it didn't have that effect. And you guys are showing, the United States is showing, that even here, a politician who speaks from the left, calling for a political revolution, that's not a term that you've heard in this country since Reagan. Reagan used the term a lot. But, you know, attaching it very clearly to what seems to us, of course, in Canada, nothing very exciting, but for you guys it is, single-payer health care. And, you know, unlike Syriza, which called for the public ownership of the banking system in typical American radical fashion, he's trust-busting. He's calling for the breaking up of the big banks as though the small ones aren't shysters. Nevertheless, this is remarkable. And what's so interesting about, I just was thinking about this as I was thinking about how to approach this talk. What's so interesting about these developments is how the roots of each of the four radical left stirrings are so different, so institutionally different. Syriza comes directly out of the communist tradition. The break, the democratic break from it that Eurocommunism represented from 1968 on, when in the wake of the invasion of Prague, the Communist Party of the Interior was created. And then, and I'll talk about this a bit more, with the Gorbachev moment and then the collapse of the Soviet Union, a whole bunch of other splits in the old Communist Party led to the realignment that produced the Sinas-Pismos alliance, which is the basis of Syriza. Podemos is a very, very different beast. The parallel beast in Spain is Izquierda Unida, which really was the first successful Euro-Communist Party. 1982 made significant electoral breakthroughs, theoretically very, very interesting. Retain the strong working class base, much stronger than Sinas-Pismos, which has much more been a salaried workers' party, a teachers' type of party, etc. No, Podemos is directly a product of the anti-globalization movement, including its, you know, anarchist zeitgeist. Overlaid with, and understandably in the Spanish case, a link to the pink tide in Latin America, with certain elements of the kind of populism that Chavez represented, we'll have to see, maybe even Perón at one point represented in Latin America. And the difference is so remarkable because Iglesias, the political scientist who was the leader of Podemos, made his breakthrough into Spanish political discourse on a television show called Fort Apache. and the sound music to the introduction of that show is Marchionne's music from The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. It's Clint Eastwood. Fort Apache was a 1948 American film with John Wayne, hardly a lefty, nor is Clint Eastwood. Nevertheless, why they fastened on it was that it was probably the first Western that sympathetically portrayed the indigenous people. Nevertheless, still the good guy is John Wayne. You know, he's the, now, you couldn't imagine, I think, Syriza, for all of its radical leftism, and I'll come to it, doing that. It's very interesting. Moreover, you know, Iglesias and Podemos often speaks in terms of we are neither left nor right, trying to break with that old image of the left. And sometimes it even speaks of the party as an electoral machine. And although, you know, it may be that Tsipras and the people in government are treating the party as an electoral machine at best, if they're not ignoring it, they would never say that. Corbyn comes out of something entirely different. He comes out of a non-Marxist party, the furthest thing from an anarchist one, although he may dress like an anarchist. You know, what he represents is that current in the British Labour Party, which has always been more Methodist than Marxist, which is socialist and does have a very strong attachment to its working class base. I knew it best through Tony Benn, and it was in the crisis of the 70s that it emerged as most creative, arguing that unless we democratize the Labour Party, we can't democratize the British state. Something that I'm going to return to in the examination of Greece and the dilemmas we face today. Corbyn represents that, and everyone thought that was nailed shut and dead by Murdoch and eventually Blair, and here it explodes again. Very, very interestingly, but a very different beast than the other two. And then, obviously, Sanders, out of the Democratic Party, and Vermont. You know, this is, again, something else entirely. Nevertheless, there are real radical left similarities in all cases. And interestingly, although they always put adjectives on it, none of them are afraid of the word socialism 15 years into the 21st century. Very, very interesting and important discursively, I think, after what happened in the latter half of the 20th century, the way in which both social democratic, which most socialist parties turned out to be, and the Communist parties, very clearly by the 1960s, had shown that they had run their course as agents of transformation already. So this is all very interesting that this is happening, and the way it might come together is really going to be interesting to watch. Now, the trouble is that were they to succeed, the difficulties of transforming an existing capitalist state, whether it's the American Empire or whether it's a peripheral state like Greece, whose every department's budget is dependent on development funds from Brussels. Every one of them would face enormous contradictions, dilemmas, and barriers. And in such a context, and this is what I want to try to think through today, it wouldn't be surprising, and it hasn't been surprising in the case of Syriza, that those with radical socialist ambitions, goals, ideals, would be not only disheartened by the barriers that the very success throws up on entering the state, but they would become the most severest critics of those who succeeded. And given the rise of the right, especially in Europe and the United States, what comes up in this context in a really, really frightening way is whether the left will be bickering with itself as it did in the early 1930s with the rise of fascism. you know, there are echoes already in some of the reaction to what Syriza did, of them being social fascists. Not quite that term, but there are echoes of it. So on the other hand, not to be critical, not to try to retain the goals, the ideals, etc., is very problematic, obviously. So, you know, this is really, I think, very much related to the rise of the right. It's not just something different. Right? Okay. I'll mainly then turn to the dilemmas of Syriza. Let me explain, first of all, how I happen to have come to follow the development of the Greek radical left so closely. It's one of the great advantages of teaching graduate students. I first went to Greece as a tourist in the late 1970s with my wife and very small children. They were, I think, 2 and 4, and fell in love with the country. I mean, it just seemed I should have been born there in almost every respect. But alas, I wasn't, and I returned to Canada. And not a year later, a young man showed up to do a PhD with me on the failure of PASOK. This was the party that really came out of the Greek centrist party, but during the dictatorship with Papandreou at York University, an economist at York University, while he was in exile. My barber used to play the accordion for him at rallies in Toronto in the early 70s. They had a very radical program, and more radical in some respects than Syriza's was, including pulling out of NATO, which Syriza's never raised. Very quickly, not least because they came out of the very much establishment and incorporated clientelist centrist party in Greece before the junta, they embedded themselves in the clientelism of the Greek state. This young man had briefly joined PASOK, the PASOK youth, stayed for about 4 months in the mid-70s, and then come to do a PhD with me before this was actually clear on how PASOK would embed itself in the clientelism of the Greek state. He's become one of my closest friends. He married a Canadian economist, went back to Greece to do his military service. I was best man at his wedding. Being best man is a very big thing in Greek families. I'm still introduced by his partner as the best man at their wedding, even though they've split up since. That became a important introduction, and he was one of the founding members of Sinis Pismos, so I always knew about his party.
What is his name?
His name is Michailis Spurdalakis. He has a wonderful piece on Syriza in the 2013 Socialist Register, which you might want to look at. There's a number of pieces on Syriza in that volume. But I've also, because I've done so much work on trying to develop the Marxist theory of the state, and I was one of Miliband's students, etc., my recent work on the American Empire, on the internationalization of the state, has drawn heavily on Poulantzas. I was also often invited to Greece to talk about that. And the research institute of Sinis Pismos, and now of Syriza, is the Poulantzas Institute. So I was able to not only continue to enjoy visiting Greece, but also to get to know a great many people on the Greek left and follow the situation somewhat closely. When I first got to know Cinespismos in the 1990s and meet people in it. It was not only a devotedly Europeanist party. It was clearly heading in a social democratic direction. There was nothing really all that exciting about it, I have to say. In the early 2000s, around 2000, some people from the youth wing of the party, who had been earlier in the youth wing of the Communist Party, I think profoundly affected by the anti-globalization movement above all, having been at Genoa and seen those massive demonstrations and confrontations, came back to Greece and began to move the party towards a more critical orientation to European integration. They began to get resolutions passed at party conferences by 2003 that spoke in terms of economic and monetary union in Europe, having brought about a neoliberal Europe under the hegemony of the American Empire. They also, and one of them was Tsipras. Another was his campaign manager when he ran for mayor of Greece in 2007, Andreas Kouritsis, who's just left the party this summer. Anyway, there were a number of them which played a very important role in shifting the party and also shifting it towards a more diverse set of linkages with the broader Greek left. So by 2004, an alliance was created called Syriza out of this party, Sinospismos, which allied itself with Maoists, with elements of the international Trotskyists, linked often to your ISO here, and even to some libertarian elements in Greece. And there was already, by the late 90s, early 2000s in Greece, some very, very interesting young anarchists doing very interesting actions in Athens and elsewhere. So you began to see a turn. And when I was there in 2008, I was invited to give the Poulantzas lecture in 2008. I had just come from Berlin, where it was the 40th anniversary of 1968 and the youth wing of Die Linke, the left, radical left party in Germany, had a big conference on 1968, and I was actually interested. And I spent most of my time there talking to people in Die Linke about what was going on at the base of that that party. And it was very clear to me that very little was going on. You know, the attempt to create a new type of radical socialist party, successive to parliamentary social democracy and Stalinist communism, or democratic, quote-unquote, centralist communism, very much depends on, you know, its ability to sink new roots in working class communities, almost to engage in a new process of class formation, given what's happened to the working classes in the last 30, 40 years, how diversified they've become, how balkanized they've become, how their communities have been shattered, etc. And it was clear that Die Linke wasn't doing this. I immediately went from there, having been invited to give this Poulantzas lecture, and happened to arrive at the time of the student revolt in Athens in December 1968. And you immediately saw the great difference that Syriza represented. It threw itself entirely into supporting, it was the only parliamentary party that did, into supporting the students. You know, 500 high schools were occupied. Every university in the country was occupied. The Communist Party, predictably, said this was a matter of the Greek secret service and foreign elements who were stirring up the students. This cost them electorally. They had reached 10% of the vote after Tsipras's very impressive run for mayor of Athens. He had been elected leader, and they were upwards of 10% in the polls, or over 10% in the polls by this point. And by virtue of supporting the students and the massive reaction to this in the Greek media and from all the other parties, et cetera, they went down to about 5%. It produced a bit of a split in the party, et cetera, but it reflected a sense that they were genuinely interested in linking themselves with what was going on in the streets. This was replicated, and I'll have to jump here again, once the euro crisis erupted. And the Greek version of the indignados, the outrage is the translation in Greece, began to be seen in a series of general strikes. One has to be careful with general strikes in Greece. General strikes, it gives you the sense that these last a long time. These are usually one day protests. And there were like 150 of them in Greece after 2010. Nevertheless, they were remarkable, and some of them were very large. And then the occupation on Syntagma Square was in 2011 through May and June, and then again later in the year in October was remarkable. And Syriza again was deeply involved in this at every level. So it looked like a different party. The breakthrough occurred in March 2012 when Tsipras suddenly said in a television broadcast that they were not running in the next election to do better. They were running to stop the torture of the Greek people, and they would form a government with anybody that would join them in doing so. And this had a remarkable catalytic effect on Greek politics. I was there invited, funnily enough, by the far-left party, the anti-European, called Antarsia, also an alliance of Trotskyists, Maoists, anarchists, etc., which generally gets less than 1% of the vote. I'd been invited to speak to their summer fair. All these Europeans have summer fairs. All the European parties have them. Tariq Ali was invited at the same time. And even though we were paid for by Antarsia to come and talk to them, of course, Tariq had 1,000 people to speak to, I had 200 people to speak to, we both told the Antarsia militants that they should vote Syriza, to the chagrin, you can imagine, of the people, there, our hosts. And I, in fact, spent most of my time talking to people in Syriza. Attended the launching of the platform, the program, to the Central Committee and assorted other senior groups in the party. And it was very moving. You saw elderly men and women get up at that meeting when that program was presented in tears and say, "This is our time." These were people who had lived through the Civil War. What I was struck by was the sense in which people who would go on to become cabinet ministers in 2015, who I spent a lot of time with, above all, Aristides Baltas, who is a very famous Greek philosopher, used to be an Althusserian, spent in recent years working on Spinoza much more. In any case, he became this year Minister of Education and Culture. I interviewed him for the Register in 2013. And what was so interesting in talking to him and others was the great concern about the party. Was the party adequate to us making this electoral breakthrough? They would mostly articulate that in terms of this state is corrupt. It's utterly corrupt. So it's not just a matter of coming in with a alternate set of policies. And they had developed, Sinas Pismos had developed a 400-page program in 2009, 2010. Very, very detailed. But it isn't just a matter of coming in with policy. Where are we going to get the experienced, honest people capable of going into the state and transforming it? Right. There clearly aren't enough in the party. What does that mean? They wouldn't say as much what I was hoping they would say, which was if they took all of those capable people out of the party and took them into the state, who would be left in the party to act as cadre, to be educators and mobilizers? But they were aware of this. And what was especially interesting, again, was that immediately they got 16% of the vote in May 2012, 17%, they were the second party. And in the June election, nobody could form a government, therefore. So there was another election a month later, and they got 27% of the vote, 71 seats. What was so interesting was this. First of all, that what had developed along with the general strikes, the protests, the outraged occupations of the squares, etc., was also in the wake of the fact that Syriza, that Greece was in a depression. In this particular capitalist crisis, the first great global crisis of the 21st century, the fourth great crisis in capitalism's history, the one from 1873 to 93, the Great Depression, the 1970s stagflation, and this one. This one has not, like the 1873 to 93, has not turned into the Great Depression, except in some places. And Greece was one of those places, and it was very much related to the way in which the dysfunctionality of the European Union as the Eurozone crisis emerged was so visible, whereas the American state, through the Federal Reserve and the Treasury, very quickly bailed out the banks. The British state, if they nationalized them, gave them back, but bailed them out. The Germans and the French required their banks, who were so heavily holding Greek and Spanish and Portuguese and other sovereign debt, required them to be bailed out by lending money to the Greeks, who would then have to give it back to those banks. And the condition for lending that money was the most severe austerity. And not only fiscal austerity, and monetary austerity, since quantitative easing was always much more tepid in Europe to the chagrin of the American Federal Reserve and the American Treasury, because of the Germans' obsession with moral hazard and a sound currency which would support German exports. But more than that, they got the IMF to sign on to this reluctantly. And when the IMF signed on to this, it insisted that, well, really this debt is unpayable and it ought to be written off. They weren't able to get the Germans to agree with this. But when the IMF gets involved, their key basis for getting involved is what is known as structural adjustment, is the remaking of a state which is receiving IMF funds, so that it is a neoliberal state, is a disciplinary neoliberal state. So the IMF in particular has played the role of riding on the Greek state. Some of that involves riding on it to be less corrupt, to be capable of collecting taxes, etc., but a great deal of it involves riding on it so that the priority, if you do collect taxes, goes to paying interest on bonds rather than paying pensions rather than paying public sector wages, et cetera. What blew up in Greece in the context of this depression, a decline of 25% in GNP, unemployment at that level, maybe double that for youth unemployment. I mean, this was equivalent to the depression in the United States in the 1930s. What was interesting is that what grew up in Greece, again, very much supported by Syriza, although not alone, were these remarkable solidarity networks. Some 400 of them across the country. Some of them were health clinics in which doctors and nurses, given that emergency rooms were closing down in Greek hospitals, doctors and nurses, psychiatrists, given the rise in suicide rates, were setting up clinics, informal clinics to service people, sharing pharmaceuticals. Drugs, even for the elderly, were not available at affordable costs. Food networks, where the middleman was removed and people went directly to farmers and brought farmers to markets and food was distributed that way, et cetera. When Syriza played a role in that, not alone, but most Syriza activists did, and when the 71 MPs were elected, they passed over a quarter of their salaries to the solidarity networks. One of the Syriza MPs had been very, very active, a woman, been very active, and she became social service minister in 2015. And she created a federation as an MP of the solidarity networks with full-time employees that involve some coordination. A lot of these solidarity networks have activists at the, have anarchists at the base, and they were very suspicious of this. Nevertheless, that role was played. But most important, the parliamentarians, when there was a demonstration, would come out and greet the demonstrators. That kind of attempt not to fall into the old parliamentarist mode. But what was most important is that it appeared that the leadership was turning its attention to doing something about the party's limited capacities were it to become a government. It had always been an alliance of these various different groups, Synaspismos being the oldest, the most important, the strongest, etc., but the Maoists, the Trotskyists, libertarians, etc. And it turned by the summer of 2013, it turned itself into a party. Right, with a common organization. And it produced a 20-page political resolution. This is very much Greece. They have 20-page political resolutions, effectively a manifesto. Remarkable program, which committed them not only to doing away with all of the memoranda that the previous governments had signed on to, bringing the banks into public ownership and socializing them, so it wasn't just a matter of them performing the same function, right? Stopping privatizations, democratizing the state, but above all, it ended with three or four paragraphs, a political conclusion that said this: Syriza is not the type of party that is like a slingshot that throws its leadership into the state and then leaves it there expecting it to make change. A Syriza government won't be able to do anything unless there is a catalytic, multidimensional movement of subversion in society. This is not your normal social democratic language. It's not an insurrectionary party, but this is quite remarkable. But, and here come the dilemmas. That party Congress itself was overwhelmed by procedure, with each of the former groupuscules in it trying to ensure that they wouldn't be marginalized in a unified party apparatus. There was very little evidence in 2013, or again, even I was there in 2014 when they made the breakthrough and won the European elections in Greece in the summer of 14. I was there in March just before that, talked to a lot of people. There was very, very little evidence that the party had the capacity to develop the capacities of people to get excited about the program, to understand the program, to take initiatives of their own, which would expand the government sense that you could get away with being radical, right? That you get support for being radical. You know, if you took people from the Solidarity Networks to a party branch meeting, they'd be confronted by an argument over plan A versus plan B. They've seen Pismo's leadership being utterly committed to staying in Europe. It had always been a Europeanist party. Yes, wanting a very different Europe, right? Being very critical of the neoliberal Europe, but utterly committed to staying in Europe. And the left platform wing of it, being utterly committed to getting out of the Eurozone at least, much less clear about whether they wanted to get out of Europe. And this was known as a fight over plan A versus plan B. And someone would walk in from one of the food distribution networks, and they'd see these arguments over plan A versus plan B, and they'd walk out, right? Feeling that they weren't doing anything in the community, right? I myself saw 30 unemployed people being brought to the Syriza office in downtown Athens. And there was great embarrassment. They didn't know what to do with them. Most problematic was this commitment to staying in Europe. It was always clear to me, and it always surprises me, when people got so upset when they didn't pull out in July, that this was a party that would only go as far as the Europeans would let them go. Commitment was that they would stick to their guns, bargain harder than Papandreou's son had when it was a PASOK government, and obviously than New Democracy had in the successive government. If you read Varoufakis's book, The Minotaur, The Global Minotaur, which is the United States until this crisis, it can consume all of the world's surplus. And then with this crisis, it can't do anymore. Etc. What should Europe do in this context? Well, Europe should save capitalism, although he says I'm a Marxist, right? In the current balance of forces, Europe should save capitalism by undertaking a radical New Deal-like fiscal stimulus strategy. And that above all should take the form of the ECB underwriting European investment bonds, which would be passed out to each state. Which would mean that they'd get it, they'd be, you know, readmitted to global bond markets. They'd get those at relatively low interest rates again. This could spawn a large infrastructure project. That was the program for staying inside Europe. That was what Varoufakis was calling for. And very interestingly, because he's not an idiot, he's actually very smart, the very last page of the book says, "The trouble is, of course, that it's unlikely the Europeans will do this unless the Americans force them to do it." And as it turned out, the Americans were not able to, although they tried. They weren't good at it, perhaps, just as Obama was lousy at handling Congress after 2010. So was this Treasury very, very lousy at forcing the Germans in particular to do this. I think it might have been different with Summers and Rubin in the 1990s. In any case, the man who is now finance minister, who succeeded Varoufakis, produced a book in 2013. His name is Euclid Tsakalatos. He's a student of the Marxist Oxford political economist Andrew Glynn. He used to be a militant in Britain. He wrote the resolution for the 1976 Labour Party conference during the IMF crisis. Which called for, and it was passed, nationalizing the the British banks and insurance companies. He became much more moderate as he got older, but nevertheless, Tsakalatos's book as well, while it's more explicitly Marxist than Varoufakis's, is very internationalist as opposed to national, looking for a national solution. And it essentially is, you know, when we're there, we will say this, we will talk this way in the European circles, right? It was always clear to me that they would not go further than the Europeans would let them go. Now, it was not clear how far they would let them go, right? And because Europe has neoliberalism in its DNA, because it, and I mean that, it goes back to the Treaty of Rome. Implicitly in the Treaty of Rome, although the balance of forces was very different then, implicitly in the Treaty of Rome, the goal was open capital markets and free trade. That was the goal. They eventually took them until 2000 to get there, but that was the goal, right? So, a party that calls for public ownership of the banks in a permanent way and then democratizing them, right? You saw in the case of Portugal, it was said publicly, they don't usually say it publicly, the president of Portugal came out when Bloco and the Communist Party were going to be in alliance with the Socialist Party after the recent election in Portugal. He said explicitly, we can't have such parties in Europe, even if they're pro-Europe, right? And the very large question is raised in this context of whether a Socialist Party, and look, insurrections aren't on the cards, whether a radical Socialist Party capable of getting elected is capable, within the framework of the European Union, of being accepted as a legitimate government. So pulling out of Europe is understandable. No one wants to talk about that. Syriza never could have gotten elected if they talked in terms of pulling out of Europe. Inconceivable. The left platform is always fuzzy about this. Yeah, you need to get out of the euro, we'll go back to the drachma, but they don't talk about getting out of the EU. But if you go back, you leave the drachma, you would have to have import controls. Inside the EU, you can't have import controls, right? Even aside from nationalizing the banks, right? The consequence was always clear to me, and this was before 2015, before the election, would not be something easy. So the dilemma was clear before the election. Upon the election in January, they came very close to majority government, not quite. The communists wouldn't form a government with them, so they formed a government with a fairly honest, but nevertheless fairly right-wing and notoriously anti-immigrant little party, ANEL, which they were able to manipulate remarkably. And they did immediately some very remarkable things. They introduced humanitarian legislation without letting the troika, the representatives of the IMF, the ECB, and Brussels, vet the legislation beforehand, which had been required of Greek government since 2010. They simply didn't show them the legislation, said it had to go too fast, and they introduced it. This was no small thing, that humanitarian legislation. It was food stamps, it was housing support that affected immediately about 300,000 people. In a country of 10 million, that's pretty good. By March, despite having this government as a partner, they passed legislation granting citizenship rights to the children of refugees and immigrants that were born in Greece, right? No small thing. Yet, by February 20th, they signed an agreement with the Europeans that they would enter into a period of negotiation towards a new agreement this September, right? And it was obvious that they were therefore going to remain within the framework of trying to work something out that would loosen the purse strings of the ECB in particular, maybe get some debt reduction, right? But within the context of neoliberalism. my friend Tariq Ali, who had told the Antarsia people to vote for Syriza, immediately came out on the Verso website and wrote a thing saying what Tsipras should have said. Well, I was angry with him because, you know, I felt, what was he telling them to vote for? Didn't he know that they weren't going to leave the EU? They were going to try to bargain something within it, right? In a much more, you know, aggressive and purposeful and left way. And that's what dragged then on into the summer, with the government being drip-fed. There was clearly some expectation on the far left, in Syriza itself, outside of Syriza, maybe more broadly on the international left, that Tsipras was Kerensky. That this was the February Revolution and, you know, there'd be a wave of popular outpouring that would bring about the October Revolution later in the year. And I think people really, when the referendum was called finally, had stars in their eyes about this. On the part of the Europeans, there was a Ramsay MacDonald strategy. And when I talk to the Greeks about this, they mostly don't know what I'm talking about. Does anybody in the room know Ramsay MacDonald? Ramsay MacDonald was the first leader of the Labour Party who was elected Prime Minister of Britain, first in 1924. He had been a pacifist in World War I, working class guy, etc. Faced exactly the same problems as Corbyn. Would they wear mourning clothes when they went to visit the Queen? In his case, he was very keen to wear mourning clothes. was out in 9 months being brought down by a made-up scandal that Zinoviev had sent a letter to that Labour government. And he'd been brought down by this, you know, it was like the Protocols of Zion at about the same time. And then he was reelected at the beginning of the Depression in 1929 again. Again, it was a minority government, although a larger one. They were in, you know, the same situation Syriza was in, and were pushed into the situation of cutting back repeatedly on relief payments. And finally, the Labour Party broke and said, we're not going to support this. And Ramsay MacDonald formed a coalition government with the Conservatives, kicking the Labour Party away, taking with him as Chancellor of the Exchequer Snowden. And that government, after there was another election later in the year, immediately went off the gold standard. And Ramsay MacDonald and his Chancellor said, oh, nobody told us we could do this. In any case, I think the European strategy was the hope that Tsipras was so popular that he and his deputy prime minister, Dragosakis, an old-style communist who moved to the democratic left but had been in a coalition government in 1990, and pretty pragmatic guy, as many of these old commies are, that they would form a national unity government. That didn't happen either. In fact, by May, as they were being drip-fed, overnight lending, not being given quantitative easing, etc., they didn't pay an IMF debt that came due. It's the first country since Zimbabwe that had reneged on an IMF debt. And they were facing the question with the Europeans saying, we aren't going to allow you to introduce some of the very basic reforms like the return of collective bargaining that you want, the increase in taxation on the rich that you want, et cetera. A big European scheduled debt was coming due, and they were up against it. They made a final proposal at the end of June, which, if you want to see class struggle, you can see it on a piece of paper. Their final proposal was, we would increase corporation taxes to 29%. We would introduce a one-time only 12% special tax on profits for 1 year. We would reduce the value-added tax on food from 13% to 7%, on basic food from 13% to 7%, that kind of thing. We'd introduce the collective bargaining legislation. The Europeans came back and said, you have to reduce the corporation tax from 29% to 28%. You can't have the 12% one-time-only tax on profits, and the basic tax on the tax on basic food has got to go up by 6% rather than down. Here you see the class struggle on a piece of paper, and it isn't just a matter that people are ideologically driven or evil. It's logical. If you're trying to raise revenue to pay off bond debt, what is a 12% tax on profits actually going to yield? Any accountant would say, I don't know what it's going to yield. Right? You're damn sure if you increase the basic tax, the fat tax on basic food, the VAT, to 13%, that people are going to have to eat. The poorest people are going to have to somehow buy that food. You know what that's going to yield you as an accountant. Right? So you see the way in which these kinds of understandings are embedded in the very fiscal structure of states and their taxation systems, etc. It was over that that Syriza called the referendum. It was never a referendum about leaving Europe. What they saw themselves as doing was doing what the young Papandreou in 2011 had not done when the first memorandum was imposed on him. Right? He had mooted calling a referendum, had come back from a meeting, actually of the G20, but a meeting of the Europeans, which Obama had chaired. So interesting in terms of the role of the American state in all of this. And they had been demanding this memorandum. He said, I can't do this. I have to go to the Greek people. And they went bananas. Look, when you get elected as a prime minister, you join our club. Right? You can't go call democracy on us when you do this. And his own party didn't support him, or at least some of the senior leadership in it didn't support him. And he backed out. He didn't call the referendum. Well, for Tsipras, calling the referendum was proving that they were not like the other governments, right? They were going to be democratic. Draghisakis was very unhappy with this, right? You're thumbing your nose at the Europeans, right? The Europeans responded by stopping the drip feeding to the banking system overnight, and they had to introduce, during the week of the referendum, capital controls, right? Now, for most poor people, not being able to take out more than 60 euros a day was no big deal, right? But in terms of what it does to the economy, even though, you know, if you were a firm or a corporation, you could negotiate for more, that, you know, is difficult to do. There's bureaucratic stuff that goes on. It's hard. It does seize up an economy, right? And it scares people. And the Europeans knew what they were doing. In that context, to get 61% was staggering. And it did suggest that were Tsipras to have faced the brick wall as he did, that he probably could have left the Eurozone and retained 50% support, I would guess. But as he recently said in an interview with Paul Mason, the Guardian journalist who's done a good video, which you should watch, on the first year of the Syriza government. You know, I would have been Jesus Christ for 3 days. And then the consequences of this would have sunk in. Right? And of course they would. It's not inconceivable that Greece could see itself through a very, very difficult period, but it would take years. The temptation, the need perhaps to take money from the Iranians or from Putin would be great. Nobody talks about this ever, ever. But you don't even hear it on the left. I think that the CIA still has its largest station in the Mediterranean in Athens. Right? What are the consequences of taking money from Iran or Putin when they're the kinds of face-offs that there are in the world today in terms of the geostrategic implications of this, right? So some people with, you know, great bravado on the left of Syriza, on the left platform, you know, will say things like, well, you know, this won't take that long, we'll go into the drachma, we'll work out itself out in 18 months, if the bourgeoisie doesn't go along with this, we'll shoot them. You need balls. I mean, one of them, the most vociferous, I won't name him, just said this to me at a meeting in Paris. The trouble is they don't have balls. Right? I've known this since 2010. They don't have balls. And I thought to myself, well, apart from the consequences of we'll just shoot them kind of logic that the left has suffered in the 20th century, the Greek police or the Greek military would shoot the bourgeoisie because a left government tells them to? Especially since, and this is perhaps the most telling thing of the contradiction, as Baltas said to me as Minister of Culture and Education, the largest ministry in Greece, we have done nothing to change the state when I interviewed him in May. The woman that I was speaking of, who became social service minister, complained that when she now tried a social service minister to talk directly to the people in the solidarity networks, Syriza MPs complained. Why are you going over our heads to our constituents? They should be coming through us. Now you can somewhat understand it, right? But when she complained about this, they went bananas, right? So changing a state is difficult. Changing as encrusted a state with layers and sediments of clientelism and corruption that go back to, what, 1830 in the Greek case, right, is all the more difficult. I've often wondered whether Syriza's historical role would be to introduce a Weberian rule of law state in Greece. What an irony, right, for a radical left party. Right? Okay, so what happened? I'll end with this. The Europeans were very angry. Syriza, having won the referendum, went back to what they had proposed. 29%, the 12% profits tax, collective bargaining rights, the same tax on VAT for basic food. And because of the Kerensky mentality, the left platform inside Greece, having seen the enormous outpouring of support, and it was possible that people might at that moment support a break with Europe, right? When this was reintroduced before Tsipras went to negotiate with the European finance ministers the weekend after the referendum, they broke and capitulation was screened. This was before the negotiation, for going back to what they had originally proposed. Right? That's when the word capitulation was first used. I got very angry with this and wrote a piece against it and became notoriously known as a social democrat and apologist and so on. And I was mainly angry because they hadn't waited for the negotiation at least to see what would happen, right? Well, what actually happened was that, yes, Holland and the other social democrats said, look, we've got to give them more space. Right? They clearly have a lot of support, right? The Germans, and Schäuble in particular, responded by saying, no, who needs them? It's obviously not just the socialists that are the problem, right? The Greeks, you know, aren't good enough to stay in, right? Go. Right? So the negotiations really became amongst the others over finding a form of words that would be strong enough to satisfy the Germans without kicking the Greeks out. And what they were faced with was a draconian structural adjustment program of the type that the IMF imposed on so many Latin American countries in the 1980s, right? With, above all, a demand that all legislation really be vetted. Right? You didn't vet all the legislation with us. You really have to do it, et cetera. The IMF helped a little because they said, look, we're only going to sign on to this if you actually give at least a hint. You don't have to say it publicly. That you will indeed allow a restructuring of the debt because it's just not viable, right? Nobody's going to invest in this country unless they see that there'll be, for 15, 20 years, not a danger of default. But by virtue of the IMF being in, the strength behind structural adjustment is all the harder. You know, this is what political life is. And at 5 in the morning, Tsipras and Tsakalatos, now the finance minister, Varoufakis, they wouldn't negotiate with after the end of April, decided at 5 in the morning, well, in the hope that there will be a debt restructuring. And we did fight and get, a bank bailout privatization fund would be held in Athens rather than in Germany, etc. They caved under enormous pressure. But it was always obvious they would, because they would not break with the EU. This was in their DNA. Amazingly, Cyprus's popularity did not go down. Greeks saw it as these guys fought as hard as they could against enormous odds. And his popularity stayed at 60-70% after this. But the party split. The left platform voted against this, repeatedly did so, as they were required. In order to start getting drip-fed again, they had to introduce certain types of measures. Every time they had to introduce one, they didn't have a majority in their own party. Right? There was an uproar inside the Central Committee. The government already had paid little attention to the party in the months that it was a government. It was totally preoccupied with, being inside the state. And it wouldn't call a Central Committee meeting. Tsipras finally promised to call one before he would call an election in the fall to reestablish the legitimacy of the government. And then he went ahead and called an election without calling the Central Committee. This led the left platform to break and form a new party called LAI, Popular Unity. It also led a great many people to leave, including who didn't join LAI, who are also committed Europeanists. But like Andreas Kourtzis, I mentioned, who was Tsipras's campaign manager and spokesman for a long period on the Politburo, on the executive for a long time, and the one most oriented to building cadre capacities for education and mobilization in communities, etc., he left as well. Even the general secretary of the party, who had also been one of the youth that had come with Tsipras, left the party. Imagine. Rather than standing up and saying, well, I'm the one who should call a Central Committee meeting. Why is it the leader? I'm the general secretary of the party. You could see the extent to which a parliamentarist party, even one that is as conscious about the problems of it, right, being capable of kicking away the party. They got reelected. As you all know, LAI didn't even get 3% of the vote. People are very disoriented, especially activists, especially one of the leaders of the solidarity networks. A woman said to me, I was so angry, I didn't know whether to shoot Tsipras or shoot myself. And there's a general feeling like this. It's very clear that, and Tsipras has said this, that they want the party to be the conscience of the government, as though we're a priest, right? Rather than an organizer or a mobilizer, right? So these are the dilemmas we face. Is it betrayal? I think people who say that are cynical. I think they're sectarian. I think they're immodest. In how many places have we put ourselves in such a difficult situation? I think the Greeks who stayed with Tsipras are wrong to say, well, what this proves, because Tsipras has never said this is a good thing, this new memorandum. They always say this is a coup, it's been forced on us, we don't believe in this. They're clearly hoping there'll be a restructuring of the debt. They were promised it privately by the end of the year, and then when it became clear the Spanish and Portuguese elections were going to be at the end of the year, that was postponed. They're still hoping for ways around this. They do have a parallel program. They want to put primary emphasis on providing primary health care through whatever they can save in raised taxation that doesn't go into balancing the budget, et cetera. But their line tends to be that what has been vetoed is democracy in Europe. And a lot of the people to the far left of them say that as well. But I think that's cheap and easy. Because, yes, Greek democracy has been vetoed. But one needs to remember that the Slovakian government is also democratically elected. And a Slovakian government was defeated over it having lent money to Greece. Slovakia, in fact, has the largest portion of its budget in loans to Greece, even though it's a small portion of the total loans to Greece. And a Slovakian government was defeated over this. So there you see Slovakian democracy checking Europe, if you see what I mean. So it's not that easy. Even the Merkel government, it's a bit like Obama. Her ability to get some of which compromises she's tried to get through her own party, she hasn't been able to carry her whole party. Now, you can say, as the Americans usually do in international negotiations, we'd love to do this, but Congress won't let us. Right? They don't mean it, and it's a way of negotiating. And the Germans do this too. The dilemma is greatest in terms of Grexit. Is it possible to leave Europe now if you're not Germany? Given the degree of integration of the economies and of the state budgets into the European apparatus, what type of a rupture does that entail, with what consequences, militarily as well as in other ways? We need an international strategy, therefore, Varoufakis and Mélenchon of the Parti de Gauche and Oscar Lafontaine from the Left Party are founding a campaign for democratic Europe. I think it's called 2015. That's a long way off, in which they're arguing we need simultaneous movements, but parliamentarist electoral movements in each European state. It's difficult to see where that would go in a coordinated way. What is perhaps most difficult is how to rethink the question of reform or revolution for the 21st century. Insurrections are, as Engels said in 1896, most unlikely to succeed. So the only game in town may be election. Is it possible to begin a transformation of the state in a way that doesn't lead to a rupture of the state, a dysfunctionality? What type of party would have to already be created to be able to sustain the capacity of people in society to throw up the type of support, the type of imaginative projects, etc.? 400 solidarity networks is nothing if you're talking about such a transformation, right? These seem to me the dilemmas, and I don't have answers to them. But it's what we ought to be talking about rather than throwing around words like capitulation. Thanks. Sorry I went on so long. Thanks.